daily operations, what difference does it make? Can they carry negative equity indefinitely?
I will take a few. Let's see if anyone else. Yes.
It's for engineering behind the lessons. I have two questions. That's great. First of all, if you're accept that your trend growth rate is up 10.2%, is 2% the realistic inflation target you have? And because you're so far from the 2% target, can the Bank of Japan continue to say that they will continue doing what they're doing until they reach 2%?
Connor, I have a lot of questions. There are 12 questions. First of all, just in terms of liquidity in the bond market. So Japan is spending 50 billion per annum on the Bank of Japan buying 80 billion. So what is the impact on liquidity in the underlying bond market? And does the Bank of Japan care about that? Does it look at that? And does it monitor that? And maybe secondly, what do you think is going to happen to these underlying assets? How will the Bank of Japan ultimately unwind this position, if at all? And what lessons do you think there are for Europe in that regard?
You know, even though central bank fall into the negative equity, they can operate, no problem. So this is really not a technical issue, it's political. How the public and media in a global world will look at this issue. First of all, in a contemporary world, no major central bank ever fall into the negative equity. So there are some emerging economy central bank which have a problem, but no major central bank in the world face it. So in terms of operation-wise, they can continue. But probably at some point, if they have a negative equity for many years, I think at some point, government have to intervene and recapitalize the central bank. Okay? Then there will be problem. So the issue is, since all the central banks are independent, right? Also, we have a different accounting system, different disclosure system, different, completely separate public enterprises. Then, to begin with, like monetary policy board member like me, when I was working there, I think we always, whenever we decide monetary easing, we always have to pay attention to the impact on the balance sheet, right? In such a way that not to deteriorate the soundness of balance sheet. And that is a basic idea. So each central bank, all central bank, I'm pretty sure they are looking at soundness, okay? And to make sure that the balance sheet will not deteriorate, because all central banks want to avoid the government intervention, okay? So this is the whole idea. But the issue is, I think, related to the second question, then what is more important? Achieving 2% price stability, or central bank's balance sheet risk and side effect? I think ECB is very clear, because you set price stability as the most important mandate. So even though there will be growing financial instability issue, the central bank cannot stop it just because of that. I think ECB policy is very clear. But otherwise, like the United States or Bank of England or Japan, it's not clear. So here's the issue. So to answer to the first question, yes, operational-wise they can do it, but it's more political. Maybe they think that this is a deterioration of fiscal balance. It's like a complete monetization, if they think it. But are they going to sell off the Japanese government bond? We don't know. Also, I don't know what public will think, because usually deficit in the banking sector or negative equity in the banking sector is a bad thing, right? So we don't know what will happen. So to go back to the central bank duty, I think we are supposed to do the monetary easing while maintaining soundness. This was an essential message. But if we continue unconventional monetary policy for too long, then this issue, which we used to take it for granted, we can no longer achieve two things. Then, which is more important? And this is, I think, we have to answer. It's not clear. And about 2% target, You know, I know there is a household in Japan, there is no support. You know, it's counterintuitive, right? Who want higher inflation? The corporate sector also find it very difficult to raise their sales prices. So they are hoping to have a lower inflation target. But why we need to introduce 2%? I think it's very important for Japan to have reasonable nominal GDP growth, because over these 15 years, the GDP deflator was negative. And real GDP looks fine, but nominal GDP growth 0%. And how can you pay huge aging cost, you know, huge debt? I think we need certain reasonable nominal GDP growth so that the economy is more active and generates some energies. So I think we need lowering to 1% is easy, but we shouldn't do it. And also, in Japan, the labor cost, labor shortage is getting serious. Now we have a serious labor shortage. At this stage, wages are not growing because a lot of this labor shortage is offset by housewife and elderly who take part-time job, and their wages are much lower, 60% of regular workers' wages. That's why, on average, wages is not growing. But eventually, we will face a very serious labor shortage, I think in 4 years, okay? Mm-hmm. So the wage will really start to pick up. Then it's possible that we achieve 2% from this wage dynamics. So at this moment, I think BOJ have to accept it takes longer. I don't think BOJ should try to achieve 2% through yen's depreciation, because if the yen is already, you know, already corrected, the overvalued, I don't think central bank should depend on exchange rate. I mean, small country, it's understandable, but big country like Japan is no longer depending on the export. I think we really have to admit it takes time, and then thinking about that time span, then BOJ should think what kind of monetary policy they can do. My suggestion is that because it takes so many years to achieve 2%, and the current level of 80 trillion is not sustainable, I think sometime this year or next year is going to be very difficult. If that is so, here's two choices. One is that doing current level of massive monetary easing, but the duration of doing that will be less. Mm-hmm. Or reduce degree of monetary accommodation a little bit now, say from 80 to 60 and gradually to 50, and but instead they can do longer, like ECB's decision in December. To me, I think it's better to have a monetary accommodation a bit longer, because it takes time for BOJ to achieve 2%. So this is what I'm suggesting. Okay. But it's very difficult, right? It depends on how they communicate. Draghi did very successfully in December, you know, when they decided to cut. I mean, they went back to the original level, but the market reaction was not bad. So the communication was very good. But depending on how the market react, we don't know what will happen. There's no, there's no consensus, you know. So maybe Draghi was lucky, the market understood, but we never know next time, next year, whether ECB will do successfully. Liquidity, okay, in Japan, the market highly distorted. You can imagine the Japanese government bond market is highly distorted. So you can look at BOJ's website. Every month, they release a liquidity indicator. So they closely look at like bid-ask ratio, price impact, volume, everything. Very clear, from January last year, the liquidity deteriorated even more, okay? So already, JGB market is highly distorted. What's more, the last September's this pegging policy, I think this will create a different sort of distortion, because pegging 0% such a long-term interest rate, you can see, it's really remove the price information. That is more challenging when they exit. So that's why I keep saying that when BOJ introduced this policy in September, it was better than negative interest rate, but BOJ should not continue this pegging at 0% for too long. If they do it too long, it creates another side effect. So I said This year, when the inflation turned positive, maybe BOJ should increase 0% target to say 0.5 or introduce range. You know, more flexibility is important. At that time, because the target is higher, then BOJ does not need to buy more that much. So BOJ can reduce from 80 to 60 gradually. That is the idea I'm talking, in public. Unwinding. So this is unwinding, one story. So unwinding, I don't want to say this is like a tightening of monetary policy. The idea is, in order to continue certain level of monetary accommodation, maybe we need to reduce a little bit now so that central bank can provide accommodation longer time. I think we should explain in this way, rather than like unwinding or tightening. Okay?
All right, next round.
William Scott from the Institute. There was a discussion here at the Institute last week about some of the things you're talking about, negative interest rates, cashless societies, whether central bank inflation targets were too low. Mm-hmm. Now, I know that Japan is special, and there's institutionalized sort of factors like the very high debt ratio and so on. Mm. But you know, if you just think more about Europe, mm-hmm. You can't argue that it would be easier managed if the inflation target was, say, 4%.
Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't have a lower bound problem, the problem of negative interest rates, which, you know, they're only minor, mm-hmm. but so long as you're not charging the holders of cash for holding it,
mm-hmm.
There's going to be a limit mm-hmm. on what you can, mm-hmm. How low negative interest rates can go in practice.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said, in Japan, there may be very special mm-hmm. type of factors in society otherwise governing or influencing decisions that may be made.
Mm-hmm.
But certainly a case was made last week that it would be easier managed. It's not a question of inflation being let go out of control, but that if the target were 3 or 4%, the ups and downs of the cycle would be easier managed.
Mm.
Maybe you'd like to comment on that.
Mm.
Okay.
Mm. It seems that monetary policy has been, for these policies been, haven't been so effective in terms of demand.
Mm.
So is it reasonable to say, compare that it was fiscal policy that what worked, that has done the work in terms of stabilizing?
Mm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, it has led to this. Okay, it has given a big
mm-hmm.
debt.
Mm-hmm.
But, and okay, you raised the question about is monetary policy, is it monetizing the debt? But if, I mean, would that necessarily, would that be a bad thing if it, or if it,
mm-hmm.
is it helpful if it's helping to sustain the
mm-hmm.
policy?
Mm-hmm.
Yep, right.
Well, in terms of the yen, does the Bank of Japan, does it have a target on the yen? Does it monitor weaker yen? It's generally has monitored weaker yen, and you talked about the hedge fund temporary blip, and do you see that being unwound, or what's your opinion on where the currency is?
Mm.
Okay.
So first question is about raising inflation target, right? Can I say that? So like originally in 2010, Blanchard, in those days, chief economist of IMF, mentioned that, and also Krugman and so on. You know, I think because in Japan, even 2% target, the public doesn't want it. You know, they think somehow in Japan, households have an upward bias in their perception of inflation and inflation expectation, even when there was a mild deflation. Always households felt prices are going up and price will go up. So I think the reason is that since 2000, the Japanese wages, nominal and real wages, dropping. And in the meanwhile, the food price was going up because from 2003, commodity price hike, and from 2013, yen depreciation. So consumers are very sensitive to the food prices. So while income is dropping, there's no hope for the wage increase, and price and food prices were going up. So they, I guess, started to feel the prices are high from this tighter budget. So the problem is that this upward bias is so big in Japan compared to Euro area, United States, England. I checked that. So it's very unique. So under this situation, and then there's a household survey, they and they ask, what do you think, whether the price hike is favorable or unfavorable? 80% of people say unfavorable. Now, Bank of England does a similar survey to the household. And then question is, so 2% target, what do you think about this 2% target? Okay, there's some options. More than 50% of the respondents say a 2% target is just right. If you add just right and should go up, okay, more than 60%. This is a very clear sign that in UK, inflation expectation is anchored. It's accepted, it's understood. But Japan is not that. So under that situation, raising 4%, I think even create even more anger, I think. So I understand it, but I think in Japan it doesn't help in terms of improving aggregate demand and inflation. The second question, you know, Mr. Turner, former FSA in UK, he often talk about this helicopter money. His idea is that because Japanese debt is so huge, there's no way to for the government to to pay it. So then, whatever government does the fiscal stimulus, everybody worry about the future, higher tax, lower expenditures, so people do not consume. So fiscal policy is not stimulus. So he's saying that maybe the Bank of Japan right now have a lots of interest-bearing perpetual bond, exchange it to the non-interest-bearing perpetual bond. Okay, and in that way, if the public understand that and public feel okay, so now I don't have to pay higher taxes and do not need to face lower expenditure in the future. So this intertemporal government constraint will be modified. That is his idea. That's reasonable, understandable, but I really think, I don't think that will generate demand. Why? Because we have already aging society. More than 20% of people are above 65. Everybody worry about how long they will live, and then and they want to maintain certain income. So if the country is already highly, already have a very high level of aging, I think that part is dominate. You know, so and the idea is understandable, but it's not. That doesn't mean it will generate demand. And also, the idea of this idea means that BOJ will keep government bond forever, right? I mean, should we do it? Because monetary policy is supposed to be temporary, right? Eventually we stop it, and eventually we should get rid of that impact from balance sheet. That is the idea. But if we really tell central bank to keep it forever, that's a completely different environment. And I'm not sure if we should do it. Then if that meaning that if the central bank has no interest income, no seniorage, right? So that means central bank will have a deficit forever. So then we really have to change the current system. Because again, do you remember when I was a board member and any central bankers, we always check the soundness of balance sheet, right? And because we are director, and then we have a responsibility to maintain soundness. So then we have to get rid of this kind of idea if we want to keep the government bond forever. We really have to change the game. So otherwise, if we maintain current system, I don't think it's consistent. That's what I said to him, by the way. Directly. it doesn't fit to our system. Exchange rate, you know, any central bank, I think ECB as well, no central bank really explicitly target exchange rate and do not even take it, it's not going to be a major discussion issue, right? Of course, some people may think yen's depreciation will help. Right. So there is no target. But I think what we can say is that in a case of Japan, the fair valued sort of equilibrium exchange rate, yen dollar rate, is between 100 and 110. Okay, so it depends on the methodology. So at one point it went to 125. That was May 2015. I think that was a bit undervalued. Then some people will suffer, right? So means at that time the import prices started go up, import food prices started go up, so households started to complain. Remember, households are very sensitive to food prices. So what will happen is that when they feel the prices are going up, they have to spend more, then they reduce the non-essential expenditures, like clothes, tourism, and that's happened. I can see that from household surveys, you see? So I don't think, you know, I don't buy the idea of generating excessive depreciation in order to achieve 2%. That's not sustainable. And if household cannot accept it, in the end, central bank will lose. You know, I don't buy that kind of ideas. Yeah.
Never.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm curious. My name, I'm an author of the Institute, and I try to understand economics, but my main interest really is in the politics and the household.
Mm-hmm.
And it just seems to me that, and I'm interested in what you've told us about Japanese households' understanding of certain terms and how they react to it.
Mm-hmm.
I think that in Europe, when there was talk of quantitative easing, that there was a popular perception that there would be a trickle-down, that would give some more money to households.
Mm.
I think people now feel that quantitative easing didn't work, because it's quantitative easing which helps commercial banks and doesn't get anywhere into the economy in terms of day-to-day spending and so on.
Mm.
And I think also that the current situation, apart from, I understand the position of the ECB and at an absolutely crucial point, the intervention of the ECB has been enormously valuable. I accept that. But there is a feeling that somehow or other, the basic economic classical theories which we're following and so on, they work for the banking system and a large economy at a sort of politico-technical level.
Yes.
But in fact, they're not working for the day-to-day living in the economy.
Mm-hmm.
And this has led to two radical ideas that are of some interest to me. One, which I'm sure you're familiar with, which sounds mad when it's called the helicopter drop of money. But I'd be interested to know what you think of that idea of getting spending power into the hands of a wider population, even if it's a relatively small amount.
Mm-hmm.
And then also, there's a growing interest in what is called basic universal income. I think for similar idea, because of a similar concern, because it would be a way of doing something for households. It would be a way of bringing in some new thinking which may anticipate some of the things like aging, automation, all sorts of things.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting that it's beginning to get airtime in different places.
Mm-hmm.
So I think basically my question is, how does the view of a banking structure and so on get more accepted by the general population, that they feel it's to their advantage? And what do you think of these sort of different ideas, like the helicopter or the basic universal?
Basic universal income is like a minimum wage, something like that?
It's an unconditional payment.
Yes, it's a universal payment.
Okay, I see. I see. Okay.
Now that opens a whole can of worms, nevertheless. We could be here for.
No, I mean, I know that, but I'm just interested. I mean, particularly. Because
I've been involved in basic income for too many years, so.
I
spend a long time talking about it.
Well, I'm not looking for.
No.
But I'd be interested in a reaction,
okay,
given that I've learned so much about central banking
here
this afternoon.
Okay, I see. trickle down, yes. Also, I think Japan also expected this trickle down. But the problem is that I think in an aging society and declining population, the potential economic growth is not going up. And then initially, when the BOJ introduced QQE, I think Japan projected this potential economic growth would go up, but that didn't happen. So if this potential economic growth does not pick up, then the corporate sector do not see an increase in expected economic growth, and the household do not see an increase in expected wage. Right? So of course they don't put a lot of money in a business investment or consumption. So I think that was a problem that Japan faced, and also Europe. So as a result, like you said, radical idea came, helicopter money. You know, Mr. Stana's idea is one thing. So pure idea of helicopter money means that central bank just provide cash to people, right? I hear that ECB can do it. There is no constraint in terms of EU treaties, okay? So if they want it, they can do it. But they need to get consensus about 19 central bank. In the case of Bank of Japan, I think it's not included in the available tools. But of course, they can change the law. But I think there will be some process to that which leads to the change in the Bank of Japan law. So I don't know whether they can do it. So another way is that sort of indirect helicopter money, right? So the central bank can buy Japanese the government bond. The government use that proceed to provide money to low-income people. Small scale, but government is doing that in Japan. So in some sense, they are utilizing that opportunity, low interest rate. So if you want to call current station somewhat similar to helicopter money, they are already doing it. So, but still, it's not really enough to generate aggregate demand. So here is the issue, you know. I understand people say fiscal expansion should be undertaken in Japan, but before the long history of Japan, like 1990s and the beginning of 2000, already government did a lot of public investment. That's why you have huge debt, right? So in another word, Japan did already lots of expansionary fiscal policy in the past. So if we don't design very carefully, we just end up with a huge debt. So I don't completely deny the idea of helicopter money, but we have to design very carefully. Otherwise, we just end up with a huge debt and only undermining the fiscal discipline. So I don't deny it, but we have to do it very carefully. Yeah.
Okay, maybe we leave it there. I think the discussion on the inflation target reminded me of a discussion, I think, in this room, oh, it must be 15 years ago, when Dr. Tietmeyer was asked by Jim O'Leary, would he prefer an inflation of 0.2% or 1.8? And surprisingly, we got a straight answer, which is, I prefer 1.8 because with quality improvements, it's more akin to price stability. So that stuck in my head after all these years. So that was the great man's, that was the great man's view. I want to thank Professor Shearer. I'm not any wiser, but I am much better informed about something I knew very little about, I hope. That you found the same. So thank you very much for a really interesting presentation.